The talk today is part of the Israel in Context series and is sponsored by three units, the Schusterman Center for Jewish Studies, the Center for Middle Eastern Studies, and the Department of Linguistics. After the talk, the audience is welcome to ask questions by raising your Zoom hand and I will call on you. Our guest today, Yehudit Henshke, is a professor of Hebrew language at the University of Haifa in Israel. Her research covers many aspects of Hebrew, from Mishnaic Hebrew in antiquity to modern Hebrew in Israel of today. A major part of her published work is on a variety of Arabic spoken by Jews in North Africa, especially Tunisia. Her book on the topic won the prestigious Asaf Award from the Academy of the Hebrew Language. But what brings Professor Henshke here today is her groundbreaking work on a variety of Hebrew, of modern Hebrew, Mizrahi Hebrew, spoken by Israelis of North African descent. This variety received very little attention in modern Hebrew scholarship and is considered to be sometimes substandard or even erroneous. Professor Henshke's sensitive and careful work on Mizrahi Hebrew reveals that, contrary to the scholarly consensus of yore, the linguistic features of this sociolect are consistent with ancient local traditions and can be explained on the background of their speakers' heritage. Mizrahi Hebrew is the culmination of two sources of influence, standard Israeli Hebrew and communal North African traditions. Her research, one hopes, opens new fascinating avenues to study the development of modern Hebrew, as well as Jewish languages in the aftermath of mass immigration. I'm honored to welcome Professor Henshke to UT.
Thank you, Professor Patel, for the warm introduction. A good afternoon to all of you, all of the audience, staff, students, and guests. And thank you for inviting me to share my research with you today. The recent celebration of Israel's 73rd birthday is a good time to reconsider the faces of modern Israeli Hebrew. If Israelis' early years were devoted to intense efforts to establish a new language, at present, the Hebrew language has achieved independent status. Israeli society has crystallized, and the melting pot approach has given way to a multicultural one. My main question today is, to what extent has the melting pot vision been realized in contemporary spoken Hebrew? More simply put, is modern Hebrew a single standard language, or can one, in the seventh decade of Israeli statehood, isolate specific sociolects spoken by different groups in Israel? I claim that distinct sociolect has emerged in Israel in the speech of the residents of the geographic and social periphery. First, I will take a brief look at the origins of the sociolect currently known as Mizrahi Hebrew. Then I will address its status as seen through the eyes of scholarly study of spoken Hebrew. I will also provide examples of some Mizrahi Hebrew distinctive features, its phonology, lexicon, and syntax. Finally, I'll try to show how some of these of the features, often described as non-standard, derived from Judeo-Arabic substrate of its speakers. The story of revival, The story of the revival of spoken Hebrew is well known. In examining this process, at first, scholars primarily addressed the relationship between the emerging language and Hebrew's classic sources, the Bible, rabbinic literature, and medieval Hebrew. They also focused on setting norms for spoken Hebrew. Half a century passed before scholars began to investigate spoken Hebrew on its own. In the mid-20th century, Chaim Blank, one of the first scholars to call for the study of modern spoken Hebrew, identified two major branches of native spoken Hebrew. He termed them Ashkenazi Israeli and Arabicized Israeli. He noted that they differed in various linguistic spheres, phonetic, phonemics, grammar, and the lexicon. He also determined that the unmarked branch was Ashkenazoid Israeli, and the marked branch was the Arabicide Israeli, spoken by Israelis of Oriental origin. He cited two criteria to back his claim: the large number of native Israelis using Ashkenazoid Israeli, and the fact that non-Ashkenazi speakers also tended to adopt its name. Over time, this branch, also termed by Blank General Israeli Hebrew, came to be regarded as Standard Hebrew. Arabicized Hebrew came to be called Mizrahi Hebrew. Blank made his distinction at a significant historical juncture: the period of mass immigration of Jews for Islamic lands, which radically shifted the demographic balance in Israel's in this time. In line with a policy called from shepherd to village, most of these new immigrants were directed to geographical periphery, moshavim, and towns in northern and southern Israel. Here you see in the map the moshavim of North African immigrants. Other Arab countries' immigrants were settled in the same area. A smaller fraction was placed in defined neighborhoods in large cities. Typically, these isolated foci were populated by multi-generational families, either living together or in close proximity, or by belonging to a single community in origin. Moreover, their Zionist ideology did not generally call for abandoning their native language, Jewish languages, or to use of Hebrew. This differed from the attitude reflected in the public slogan popular from the 1920s, Ivri Daber Ivri, Hebrew speak Hebrew. The directed revival of Hebrew aimed to restore the nation in Zion, who were immigrating to the land from the four corners of the earth, an updated ancestral tradition as language of life, society, and creativity. In addition, it wanted to place a single national language in the mouth of nation with a veritable bubble of languages like ours. Thus, immigrants to Israel, namely new speakers of Hebrew, underwent two linguistic revolutions. One, the study and acquisition of a new language. Two, reduced or no use of their native tongue, in public at least. But immigrants from the Arab countries tended to preserve their communal Hebrew traditions, like the Torah and Mishnah reading, and the widespread use of their native Judeo languages, mainly Judeo-Arabic. As you will see, Judeo-Arabic forms the basis for many of the phenomena specific to Mizrahi Hebrew. Immigrants from Islamic lands continued to use their native Judeo languages at the same time as they acquired Ashkenazoid Israeli. This led to coexistence of two living languages, Judeo-Arabic and General Israeli Hebrew. In essence, General Israeli Hebrew and Judeo-Arabic remained in diaglossic relationship for decades. My research of spoken Hebrew has focused on the Mizrahi sociolect, which developed from the contact between the immigrant Hebrew communal tradition and the Judeo-Arabic and General Israeli Hebrew. This unique sociolect has been transmitted to the second, third, and fourth generations to Aliyah, to immigration to Israel. My studies also note the central influence of North African Judeo-Arabic on the Mizrahi Hebrew and its impact on the other ethnic group in Israeli periphery. Indeed, Mizrahi Israeli Hebrew continues to be spoken by native-born Israelis and not just in the geographical periphery. First, I would like to address the attitude toward the Mizrahi Hebrew sociolect in the scholarly research, which also reflects the general perception of its status. Blank distinction between Ashkenazoid and Arabicized Hebrew did not succeed in sparking a broad discussion of the different types of spoken Hebrew. Enough, even though speakers of Mizrahi Hebrew, of Mizrahi background, were about half of the Hebrew speakers by the second half of the 20th century, the scholarship focused on general Israeli Hebrew, almost totally ignoring the Mizrahi Hebrew variety spoken mainly in the periphery. More precisely, in terms of phonology, scholarly description of contemporary Hebrew largely associate Mizrahi Hebrew with the pronunciation of the pharyngeals het and ayin, seen as focal markers of the difference between the two spoken entities. In addition, the focus on pharyngeals led to the conclusion that the use of Mizrahi Hebrew was declining and that its speakers were switching to standard Hebrew. Some even predicted the disappearance of pharyngeals in a generation or two. Indeed, the scholarly discussion of Hebrew's status as Semitic language ignored the prevalent Mizrahi Semitic accent. But this prediction that Mizrahi Hebrew would disappear has not been realized. Mizrahi Hebrew continues to be spoken by native-born Israelis, mainly in the periphery. Starting in 2007, I undertook a comprehensive field study of Mizrahi Hebrew. This comprehensive field study recorded and transcribed long conversations with some 120 native Israelis from all regions of Israel. They represented a wide spectrum of Hebrew speakers, second, third, and fourth generation to Aliyah from Islamic land, and ages, including school children. The characteristics of the participants were carefully mapped according to detailed demographic, social, and linguistic parameters. The conversations were carefully transcribed, subjected to initial linguistic analysis, and tagged. This corpus, which named the other Hebrew corpus, contains more than 1,300,000 tokens. Now, based on this field study, I would like to look at some of these Sociolect phonological aspects. The initial analysis and tagging of other Hebrew corpus will reveal unique phonological issues. I address two of these issues. As I noted earlier, the pharyngeals het and ayin have not been preserved in general Israeli Hebrew. Their absence reflects the phonological system of the first Ashkenazim speakers of revival Hebrew, who generally adopted the Sephardic pronunciation, but without the gutters. Ayin was nullified or become a, and het become ha. For example, asta became asta or asta. Haver was pronounced haver. The non-realization of pharyngeals in general Israeli Hebrew also influenced the morphology of modern Hebrew. Thus, the transformation of het into fricative velar can influence its phonological environment. This can lead to the nullification of the vowel in the het, for example, classic sihaka, as opposed to modern Hebrew sihka. The pronunciation omits the half vowel a after the het. This is also the case for patterns that had lower vowels because of historical pharyngeals. For example, classic Yivchar to modern Yivchor, among others. But speakers of Mizrahi sociolect in whose modern times and language traditions the pharyngeals were realized continue to preserve the realization to differing extent. As documented in other Hebrew corpus, the pharyngeals have become a decisive marker of the Mizrahi variety. Het as unvoiced fricative pharyngeals is attested hundreds of times. Ayin as voiced pharyngeals occurs thousands of times. The realization of the pharyngeals by Mizrahi Hebrew speakers created further sociolinguistic distinction between Mizrahi and general Israeli Hebrew. Another place that the Ashkenazic and Sephardic traditions diverge is in their pronunciation of the vowel tsere or tsere. Ashkenazi Jews realize it as different variation of diphthong. They pronounce Sere as A or I, depending on where they originated in Eastern Europe. Note, for example, the words Beseder and Zefer, which Ashkenazim pronounce Beseder and Zefer, or Beseder and Zefer, and in Sephardic pronunciation, Sere is realized as monophthong E, Beseder and Zefer. Nonetheless, on the revival in Palestine, the Ashkenazi Halutzim tended to adopt the Sephardic pronunciation, especially for vowels, and refrain from use of diphthong. A language committee decision granted approval to this linguistic reality. But today, the linguistic reality is not uniform. A considerable number of speakers of general Israeli Hebrew preserve the pronunciation of Tzere as a diphthong A. And this accentual feature distinguishes between general Israeli Hebrew and Mizrahi Hebrew. The other Hebrew corpus from the 21st century indicates that the pronunciation of the tzere as a monophthong is prevalent in Mizrahi Hebrew and serves and as definitive marker of the ethnolinguistic variety. This monophthong occurs in written long tzere and of course in short tzere, in words such as a betza, not eze betza, Terot, Shteyan Bnei, not Shteyan Bnei, and the names of the letters He and Pe. It was even extended to foreign words such Facebook, Wes, and even fake news. The findings from the other Hebrew corpus were not just phonological. They also yielded evidence of other features specific to Mizrahi sociology. One is, of course, lexical, and it is to reflect the influence of Judeo-Arabic on spoken Hebrew in periphery. It is well known that the cases of contact language between languages, it is the lexicon that shows the most rapid influence. My studies of modern spoken Hebrew indicate that we find the natural interpolation and embedding of Maghrebi Arabic words and expression in Hebrew sentences in the language of the periphery. Both children and adults spontaneously integrate Judeo-Arabic words in their spoken Hebrew. At times, these words also enter general Hebrew. The Judeo-Arabic words used in the periphery belong to defined categories such as beliefs, customs and social status, holidays and ceremonies, food and nicknames, among others. These categories testify a classic process of language contact and the sociocultural motives for borrowing. Indeed, core words, religious and cultural concepts are the foremost category in lexical borrowing. I will present selected examples for only some of the categories drawn from my conversation with the informant. For the realm of beliefs and customs, I note the following examples: Hamsa, Shur, and Shlo. These three words reflect social and cultural concepts that were current among the North African Jewish community. They reflect sociocultural gaps within the community, like Shlo, and folk beliefs, Hamsa and Shur. As basic components of the sociocultural life of North African immigrants, these concepts were integrated such into modern Hebrew without translation. In addition, these three words, among others, have entered standard Hebrew. For the category of ceremonies and holidays, I mentioned two examples, Hina and Mimuna. Familiar to most Israelis, these two words are viewed by the majority as part of their distinctive Mizrahi identity. Food is another category for which Mizrahi Hebrew has penetrated general Israeli Hebrew. I mentioned couscous, matbucha, mufleta, sponge. Another distinctive category is that of nicknames. Here, too, Mizrahi Hebrew contains additional words borrowed from Judeo-Arabic that have alternatives in Hebrew. such words should be categorized as code words as well. This emotion-saturated word belongs to two groups, phon and derogatory migrants. I provide some examples. Ozala, Laziz, Ituha for phon names, phon nicknames, and Bashel, Madruba, Mizrub for derogatory nicknames. Although most of these words have direct, fluent translation into Hebrew, here Mizrahi Hebrew speakers prefer the Arabic terms, perhaps because of their strong emotional significance and link to Mizrahi traditions and culture. Time does not allow me to go into further details regarding other words or categories emerging from the Judeo-Arabic Hebrew context. However, the Mizrahi sociolect is not just reflected in speech, but also in contemporary literature, Israeli literature. A prime example is Sara Shiloh, Shum Gamadim Lo Yavo, No Norms Will Appear, which was translated into English as The Falafel King is Dead. This prize-winning novel tells the story of the family in the geographical periphery, which is under Katyusha attack, and now the mother and her children deal with the sudden death 6 years earlier of the husband's father, who ran a falafel stand. The book's outstanding feature is its author's decision to use so-called non-standard Hebrew. Indeed, one reviewer even stated, quote, No Norms Will Appear contains not a single sentence in standard Hebrew, end quote. On the other hand, the book is characterized by an unusually rich degree of literary virtuosity. A surprising feature of this book is the sharp contrast between what it termed low register, low language, and the book's linguistic vitality, the vivid imagery and metaphors found in its limited impoverished language. For those familiar with this sociolect, Shiloh's use of mistakes and forms attributed to low register may seem overdone. Nonetheless, I find this book a bold attempt to portray Mizrahi Hebrew. In approaching the question of how to describe this language, the oft-repeated notion, this is low ungrammatical language, missed the mark. I use some examples from this book to illustrate feature of Mizrahi Hebrew, whose origins lie in Judeo-Arabic substrate, in addition to the ones derived from other Hebrew codes. First, I know an example of long translation, which appears in the speech of the frightened neighbors who run to the shelter and use the phrase Chazar Lavan, return white or fail, in the meaning of Hapach Lavan, Echvir, became him. Al tizaki alav achshav, tirei oto ech Chazar Lavan. In the Judeo-Arabic, the word Reja means return to his place, but also turn into or became. Reja also serves as an auxiliary verb in such expression as Reja Mahbul, became insane, or Ja Abyad or Asfar turned pale. This paved the way for the transformation of Ja Abyad to Hebrew, to the Hebrew version, Chazar Lavan. Another feature that distinguishes Mizrahi from general Israeli Hebrew is the use of compound tenses, often regarded as a classic example of low or mistaken language. An outstanding feature of the speech of one of Shiloh's main characters is the use of the haya structure, haya plus participle. In my opinion, Shiloh somewhat overuses compound tenses as compared to their actual distribution in the Mizrahi Hebrew. Nonetheless, she correctly documents a unique feature of this sociolect, the use of compound tenses to indicate the simple past. Please look at the bold phrases. בחלומות שלהם לא היו רואים דבר כזה. אוטובוס אחד היה לוקח, היו מביאים, was seen, was taking, were taking, was making, etc. These and other examples attest to the frequent use of in non-norm of haya plus participle to denote simple past. In the first sentences, for example, hizmanti and haya lokeh, hayu mevi'im are parallel, and it is difficult to establish any difference between the tenses. This is also the case for other examples. Haya oseh, hayu rotzim, hayu mekablim, and the like do not indicate continuity, regularity, or routine, as in general Hebrew, but a simple action in the past, took, brought, etc. This makes their use in compound tenses unusual in the modern Hebrew context. But this structure is based on Judeo-Arabic especially and vernacular Arabic in general. For example, كان يعمل ماكلة, literally he was preparing food, meaning he prepared food. Another distinctive feature of Mizrahi Hebrew as reflected in Shiloh's book is the use of non-standard preposition. Some chosen examples among many others include כל הלילה היו רועדים, מי שחשבו שזה קטיושה בבית או מחבלים בבית, רק בבוקר ראו את המזנון שוכב ברצפה. They see the sideboard lying in the floor. This prepositional use appears more than once. גם שנופלת השמיכה ברצפה. The blanket falls in the floor. In standard Hebrew, the preposition would be al. The phrase is would be al arizpa. Another example of non-standard use of prepositions is מהבוקר עד לערב, standard Hebrew, מהבוקר עד הערב. Here too, I trace the influence of Judeo-Arabic. The Arabic preposition is translated directly into Hebrew as a calc. Raqad fil ard, sleep in the floor. تحت الأرض falls in the floor حتى العشية to the evening. I opened by mentioning Yom HaTzmaut. In concluding, I would like to share with you an interview from the 1970s with a first generation immigrant who described how she spent this holiday. I analyzed this passage in article where I showed how her mistakes reflect the Judeo-Arabic substrate underlying her Hebrew. Moreover, I indicated that most of the same mistakes can still be found in the Hebrew of Israeli-born native with Mizrahi origin. The translation is attempt to reflect these features. יום העצמאות היה ככה, אני לא יכולה לצאת, יש לי 7 ילדים, 1, 2 חודשים, מה לעשות, הלכנו קצת ברחוב, etc. I briefly note some features of this woman's account that can still be found in Mizrahi Hebrew today. In use by third and fourth generation, incorrect use of preposition and the use of asta, make be. Some of the features in the interview that have been retained to the present include the following non-standard usage. אחר כך הלכנו הבית. הלכנו הבית in general Hebrew. In general Hebrew, the locative verb halach attracts the preposition le, or halach le, or el, halach el abayit, or halach lateatron, and with the notation of the place, halach el abayit, or with the directional article, he, halach abayit. In essence, the second possibility predominates. In Mizrahi Hebrew, however, the common usage is halach habayit with no complementary preposition. Moreover, the phrase halach habayit and its declension are significant marker of Israeli Mizrahi sociolect and serve as unfailing source of mockery of its sociolect in Israel's satire. This phrase is long translation from of the North African Arabic phrase in Shadda. There is a continuum from this conversation taped in the 1970s with its non-normative language as spoken by first generation immigrants to Israel and the language of native born Israelis. הלכתי אצל השכנים, here too the presence of Judeo-Arabic substrate is visible. In contemporary Hebrew, the motion verb attracts the preposition le, הלכתי לשכנים, but in Arabic, msha'and. So, msha'and is the correct usage. Similar use of etzel is attested in Amos Oz, Povesham, Be'eretz Israel, Journey in Israel, Autumn 1982. In his description of the town Beit Shemesh, which was first populated by immigrants from North Africa. When Oz visited the town in the early 1980s, descendants of North African Jews formed the majority of its population. In the book, Oz cites one of the residents as reporting, "Pam avadati etzel aganat teva." Oz, with his keen ear for language, noted the unusual use of avad etzel instead of avad be, and documented it as a feature of the sociolect spoken in Beit Shemesh. As noted, this diverges from normative Hebrew, but the usage in Maghrabi Arabic, Abad Etzel Khdam'an, is a directed translation to the Arabic Khdam'an, as you see. Another feature of Mizrahi Hebrew is the use of Asa, of the root Asa, as a complement. He has time Aetzba, Kacha Shanir'e, Lokhim Et, Ro'im Ki'ilu, Urove, Vemitlachamim. In these phrases, the use of the root asa does not indicate a specific act or action, but is a filler that marks the performance or general action alone. Asa is therefore a general verb that substitutes for a specific verb and indicates some sort of activity. In our conversation, two different complements appear with the general verb. In the first utterance, there is the prepositional phrase ima etzba, which means pointing at something. In the second, the complement is a hypothetical word of comparison ki'ilu, and the meaning is imagine that they are holding rifles. Scholars have attributed the use of general imprecise words such as asa, the verb asa, by Mizrahi population to the poverty of the language and the lack of a rich vocabulary to mark distinction between objects, actions, and feelings. This pattern, however, has historical roots and was also widespread in medieval Hebrew, which was influenced by the Arabic of its time. For example, Asa Sechora, Asa Mecha'a, Asa Chanifa. In contemporary North African Arabic, the root amel, asa, make, did, functions in various contexts and creates a similar periphrastic or indirect verbal pattern. Thus, amel arsh, married, amel nar, amel sabon, etc. I also noted that such structures are quite common in the other Hebrew corpus. Some random examples include Ose Nikayon, clean, Ose Kuskus, prepare, Osim China, celebrate. Slichot Shekulam Osim, read or recite. To conclude, this lecture attempts to demonstrate the multilayer nature of contemporary spoken Hebrew and to identify the role of Mizrahi sociolect of Hebrew as a central component in this mosaic. The large number of Mizrahi Jews in Israel, and in the periphery in particular, led to the creation of identifiable Sociolect by these Hebrew speakers, often mistakenly seen as product of cultural deprivation or lack of education. This sociolect foundation lie in Judeo-Arabic language and culture. From among the many possibilities, I chose to examine several aspects of this language context: phonology, lexicon, and syntax. At present, this sociolect continues to thrive and spread among youth speakers, teenagers, and also young children. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sir Henshke. So perhaps we can thank you, Yehudit, again for coming and talking to us about this. This is fascinating and not very often discussed. So it's kind of very surprising and new to most of us, I would say. Thank you very much. Thanks.